Good morning, Christchurch. A warm welcome to you, and a welcome if you're watching us online. We gather this morning because we want to encounter God. We want to encourage each other and enter or continue to be in His presence. If you're able, please stand, or you can also do this from where you're sitting. I'm going to pray and then we're going to do a bit of a warm-up before we go into our songs. Dear God, we just take this moment to acknowledge you. Would you calm our racing hearts? If we're breathless, would you give us that pause and give us our breath back? As we come before you this morning to bring you praise, to lift our adoration to you. Amen. So for the warm-up, you need to stretch as high as you possibly can, and then as low as you possibly can. And then we're going to do a big turnaround like this, and on the way, you're going to say hello to as many people as you can. You're going to turn with your arms. If you bump into them, that's even better. Hello! Hello! As high as you possibly can again, as low as you possibly can, and a quicker hello! Hello! Okay, let's worship together.
Love is mighty and so much stronger.
are the way, the truth, and the life. And we want to live by faith, not by sight. What a great way to send our children and our children's church leaders out. Lord, we just pray that they would learn more about you as they go out this morning, and that the leaders would be encouraged in their faith as they teach and befriend and have fun with the children. In Jesus' name, amen. So if you're new to us this morning and you'd like to be a part of the children's groups, you look out for somebody with a green lanyard at the back of church and they'll help you know which group to go to. We would love to have you joining us.
Well, it's lovely to be able to see you all here. And just a couple of notices while we're just gathered here. First is, if you're new to us, you'll see the welcome lunch on the 25th of February. Maybe you've been around for a while and you'd like to find out more about the life of the church, or maybe you'd just like to connect with some of us. Well, we've got lunch on the 25th of February. So please do come. Do let Louise, who's leading today, know that you're coming. Also, we're talking a lot about sharing our faith, and so the next Alpha course is starting at the end of the month. There's some flyers at the back, and you'll see there on the 30th of January. We'd love you to come, and we'd love you to bring your friends so they get to know the good news of Jesus. Also, at the moment, while we're going through the book of Romans, we're also using the Romans course in our life groups. And so if you haven't yet joined a life group, we'd love you to connect and to join in a life group. Again, you can talk to Louise after this service or to Richard Jarvis. Or maybe you're in a prayer triplet. Why don't you take the opportunity just to maybe go through the materials with one another? It's a great way for us understanding the gospel and being able to share it. At this time of year, it's also the week for Christian unity, and so on Wednesday at lunchtime at St. Mary's, 11 o'clock, we have the service for the week of Christian unity, followed by a light lunch if you would like to be able to stay. And also on Friday night, we're hosting the interchurch quiz here, and so do put together a team of up to 8 people, and it's in aid of East Hearts Air Ambulance, so you're welcome to come and be a part of that as well. Just let the office know. All the details are on the screens here for you. But also today, I get to publish the banns of marriage. And I publish the banns of marriage between Adam Neil John Holding of the parish of St. Benedict's, Bennett's End, and between Kelly Leanne St. Ledger of the parish of Christ Church Ware. This is for the third time of asking if anybody knows any reason in law why they should not be married. You must declare it now. Let's just pray for them. And so, Father, we pray for Adam and Kelly and all others who are being married here at Christ Church this year. We ask that you will be meeting with them, strengthening them, leading and guiding them, and helping them to know your love and your grace and your strength this day. In your name, amen. And in a moment, we're just going to go into our prayers. But also, I'm just going to pray for the Tucker family, because Mike, who was well known to many of us, passed away this last week. And so we're just going to hold up the Tucker family here in this space. And so, Father, we want to thank you for Mike, for how much he encouraged this church and blessed this church. How much he blessed this town and served this town too. And Father, therefore, for Wendy and for the girls and for the rest of the family, may you continue to hold them in your peace this day. May you strengthen them. And thank you for the hope that we all share of glory, that we'll be sharing about even more later in this service. And so may your Spirit continue to lead and guide us in our intercessions this morning. In your name, amen.
Lord, we all grieve in different ways. Hello, there's a few pens. Obviously, the children's church here as well. When someone dies in this country, it's very common we send cards of condolence to the family. Not very common, though, for others to go round to the family home and give comfort to those grieving. We don't like to intrude on their grief, when maybe we should be going round as a mark of our respect to both the memory of whoever has died and show our support to the family. Maybe we think we won't know what to say. Sometimes there's no need to say anything. Lord, we ask that you will help and give comfort to all those who are grieving the death of a loved one. Give them comfort in their time of loss, and show all of us how we can give our support and help. Lord, you walked this earth in and around what we now know as the Middle East. We know from reading the Old Testament that there was never much peace there. That's one of the reasons that you were born amongst us and lived our lives. And look what we did. Why can't mankind live with each other and seek only the common good? Lord, we ask that you will use your influence on all in authority, from whatever background, to bring wars to an end wherever they are raging. We pray for the royal family, for the king as head of our church, that he had the strength of mind to speak about a subject that I'm afraid many men still ignore. For the Princess of Wales, who will be out of action for several months. Lord, we ask that you give them and the whole royal family your peace and love and strength to those members who will now maybe have to step up to take their place. So, have you made your New Year resolutions? Don't pay that gym membership. Well, just come to Christchurch, because that resolution may not last. I was privileged last week to help out with the youth session. We were looking at the time when Moses was told by you, Lord, to go back into Egypt and rescue the Israelites from slavery. He put up all sorts of objections. I'm not brave enough. I can't talk the talk. Send my brother. But you, Lord, you got angry with his prevaricating. And you told him that you would be standing next to him. Lord, get angry with us when we prevaricate. Stand by us and help us to resolve to listen to you and be ready to do your bidding. Amen.
I'm just going to spend a few minutes now preparing to come before God, preparing for our time of sung worship when we might want to respond. So we've been looking at the Romans course, maybe you've been following it in your life group as well, and this week we're going to be looking at grace, and John's going to be talking to us about how Romans reveals more about God's grace to us. Last week we were looking at sin, and this week is God's response to that. God says that his grace is sufficient for you. So we're just going to spend a couple of minutes thinking about that. My grace is sufficient for you. I feel that God has a word for people this morning. Maybe you've been trying. You know the gospel, you know about sin, you know about God's love, you know what he has done for you. And you've been trying. And absolutely, the Bible talks about how we need to work at things. But maybe all you've been doing is just trying harder, trying to do more things, trying to get better, trying to feel better. Trying to do more activities that you think are the activities that God would want you to be doing. Trying to feel better about how you might come to church or before God. But maybe in that journey of trying and trying and trying, we haven't spent long enough hearing, receiving, and believing that God's grace is sufficient. Maybe the trying is something we're struggling with. Maybe it's an addiction. Maybe it's something that we wouldn't quite want to call an addiction, but is a repeated habit that we can't break away from. I think you might feel like that's the bit of you that you shouldn't bring to God. But the passage that talks about God's grace being sufficient says that his power is made perfect in weakness. So what if we turned it around and the bits that you're most ashamed of, the bits that you're trying to hide, are where God is going to be most powerful? They're the bits that he wants to see. This morning, let's take a few more minutes now as you think about what your response might be to that, whether it's stirring something inside of you, that you need to just come back to the simplicity but the incomprehensible grace that God has for you. Lord, I just pray for anybody that this word is for this morning, who where we're trying and trying to get closer to you, Lord. And actually, we just need to come into your presence and receive your grace. Lord, we bring to you those areas that maybe we think are not for you, that you don't want to see. We bring that into our mind now. We admit to you if our schedule has got caught up with godly things, but that we know we haven't spent enough time just with you, receiving your grace and your power. Would you keep speaking to us as we worship, as we reflect this morning? More of you, Jesus, that your grace would be ministered to people this morning. Lord, we thank you that you do speak to us. We thank you that you speak to our intellect through word. We thank you that you speak to our spirit, our emotions. We thank you that you bring physical healing and restoration. Would your power be at work? Would you release our ears to be able to hear you this morning? Let's worship. Maybe you want to sit, maybe you want to stand. This is time to reflect and be in his presence.
Oh, it chases me down. Was my cross you bore, so I could live in the freedom you died for. And now my life is yours, and I will sing of your goodness forevermore. Worthy is your name. Undeniable, your praise goes on and on, and I will sing of your goodness forevermore. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve praise. Worthy is your name. Be exalted now in the heavens, as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens, as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name. Show us your glory, show us your glory, in wonder and surrender we fall down. Show us your glory, show us your glory, let everything.
Jesus, we thank you that you are with us here in this space by your Spirit. And may your Spirit just continue to minister to our hearts, to our minds and our lives as we hear your word read and then proclaim this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, looks like I'm reading, that's fine. So, Romans 3, verse 19. Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silent and the whole world held accountable to God. Therefore, no one will be declared righteous in God's sight by the works of the law. Rather, through the law, we become conscious of our sins. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. For there is no difference between Jew and Gentile, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Christ as an sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith. He did this to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to demonstrate his righteousness at the present time, so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. And then Romans 4, verse 18. Against all hope, Abraham in hope believed, and so became the father of many nations. Just as it had been said to him, so shall your offspring be. Without weakening in his faith, he was faced the fact that his body was as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, and that Sarah's womb was also dead. Yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he had promised. This is why it was credited to him as righteousness. The words it was credited to him were written not for him alone, but for us that are here gathered, to whom God will credit righteousness. For us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, he was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. Let's just pray for a moment. Father, we thank you for your word. And although there are many long words in that passage we've just read, we thank you that in the heart of it is the most amazing truth of what Jesus has done. And so, Holy Spirit, as you are welcome here in this place, as you are welcome with each and every person that's watching online, may you be speaking to us. May you be revealing parts of our lives that need to know your grace. May you be helping us to understand what Jesus has done and the new freedom and life that it brings. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, 2 weeks ago, we looked at how Paul starts his letter. And he goes, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it's the power to transform, the power to save. It's good news." And we saw last week how so often we are stuck in sin. How the world is often stuck in sin, and we are. The things that we've done that we don't want to do. The things that we haven't done that we should have done. The things that we've thought. And last week we saw that there is no way that we by our own hard work can get ourselves out. Well, this week we get the amazingly good news. The good news of what Jesus has done and how much it changes and transforms. But maybe to start to illustrate this a little bit more, when I was at Army College, we often used to do regularly the assault courses. And it's not quite modern gladiators if you were watching it last night. But actually, there was always that one big wall. And as many of you know, I was a front row rugby player, so it was great. I often used to be at the bottom of the wall, throwing people up over. That was great fun. But occasionally, everybody carried on along the course. Now, if any of you have noticed, I'm not the tallest of people. And so I would then run and jump to get over this wall and fall straight back down. I could do that as much as I liked, but there was absolutely no way I was ever getting over this wall unless two of the guys just stayed at the top and reached their arms down so that when I jumped, I caught their arms and they could help me up over the wall. And you see, that's what we've done. There's no way that we can get out of sin ourselves. There's no way we can get out of the mess we make of our lives ourselves unless someone reaches down to help to pull us up and over and out. And that's what this part of Romans is all about. It's how God reached down in Jesus to pull us up and out. To pull us and enable us to then walk free again. To no longer be trapped. To no longer be stuck in the mess of sin. We had to look last week at the situation we find ourselves in, because only then do we understand what God has done to get us out of it. You know, so often we tune into the news, but we particularly tune in when there is a story of a rescue. You know, whether there's been an earthquake and people have been trapped, and then days later they couldn't have saved themselves and someone is found. Or maybe you tuned in a few years ago to Chilean miners that were stuck underground. There was no way they could have got out themselves until the rescuer stepped in to get them out. It was on the news every day. And the point is, so often we are in that space of being stuck. That's what Romans has been very clear about. It's been very clear that no matter what, we are stuck. We cannot get out of it ourselves. And it said it's all the same for all of us have sinned. And they used the example, as Paul, into Rome at that time, both Jew and Gentile. Those that followed all the laws, who thought they could be all okay, and it wasn't quite good enough. And those that thought they could do what they like and that was okay, I'm quite a good person really, but they realized that it wasn't quite good enough. I guess we can have the same very much today. Those of us who think we're following and doing exactly everything right, but when we took a real look at our lives, we go, yeah, it's not quite 100%. Actually, it's not quite 90%. It's more like 60%. You know, or sometimes think, yeah, we're doing okay, and it's all right, and I'm quite a good person, really. And then we look back on a day and go, why did I say that? Why did I do that? I wish I hadn't. And you see, the whole point of this passage and the bit where it says the law makes us aware, the law just points out, yeah, you haven't really got 100%, and yeah, you didn't get it right there. But the point is, we keep often inventing ways that we can actually think that we hurt God, but not one of them has ever changed God's mind. Not one of them has ever changed his mind. So where we are stuck, no matter what, God chose Jesus. And Jesus came into our midst, and he lived amongst us as the sinless, perfect human being. We'll see more about that later on in Romans and more about the implications. But Jesus came and was alongside us in our mess. And Jesus was God himself reaching down to pull us out and help us over the wall. You know, the most important word here in this passage is a small three-letter word, but. But. It's so important because it's the pivot that changes the whole of the argument and it changes the whole of life. And if we understand what it is there for, it will change yours and my life this very day. Verse 20 goes, rather, through the law we become conscious of our sin. So the law points out we're not perfect. And the very next verse, but God's righteousness has been made known. And then verse 22, this righteousness is given through faith in Jesus. There is no difference between Jew and Gentile. There's no difference between if you think you're perfect or you think you're following the right ways. You know that it hasn't quite. No difference. But in the same way, there is no difference for the opportunity of salvation and a new start. Jesus reaches down to each of us to give us that new start. He reaches down into our sin and mess to give us a new start. He reaches in to help us to move forward with God, to grow and connect with God. And there are three particular images that Paul uses here in this passage of Romans. And by the way, if you do choose to do the Alpha course, we explore even more of those on week two. So please do either come or bring your friends to understand more about it. But the three images are here behind these verses. First of all, verse 24. And all are justified freely by his grace, the redemption that came by Jesus Christ. Redemption. In that space in Rome, there would regularly have been slave markets. And if you were a slave, you would be waiting, if you were to be sold in that market, worried and concerned, who's going to buy me? What's going to be next? And someone would buy you, and it was your new next step. still in slavery. And you were bought, and you were sold, and you were under the power of the person who owned you. And you and I sometimes know that we are under the power of sin and things that we don't want to do. You know, in the old school confession, we know the things that we ought to do and the things that we don't do. We know it. But rather than that power, what happens in this marketplace is God himself comes and he pays to set the person free. That's what redemption is. In this marketplace, the person who is trapped and enslaved, waiting to be sold, the new master comes in, pays, and says, you're free. That's what God does. In Jesus, the price is paid. Redeeming. You're set free. And you're set free to choose to do what you want. And that's why Paul says, I chose to follow Jesus. I chose to be a slave to the gospel, to share the great news, because once I was trapped in a system, and now I am free to know God. Once I was trapped in sin, now I am free. The price is paid. I have been redeemed. I've been set free because the price is paid. We regularly sing it. That's behind redemption. But the second one is the image of atonement, sacrifice and atonement. Two big words, verse 25. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith. You see, on one day in every year, there would be a sacrifice in the temple of Jerusalem. And on that day, one person, the high priest, would go into the Holy of Holies, and in there was what was known as a mercy seat. And they would scatter the blood of the animal on the mercy seat. And that would be, God, in your mercy, will you forgive your people? And when we take communion, we remind ourselves, this is the blood of Jesus shed for us. We remind ourselves the blood of the new covenant. So you see, this whole image, every single year, the priest had to go and put blood on the mercy seat. But behind this image, Jesus died so that we might have life. His blood is shed once and for all. His blood is shed for an atonement of sins. And as you look at the Old Testament and the New Testament, we see how the blood of God cleanses us, how it transforms us. And you know, so often we kind of go, that's nice, it's a sprinkling or it's a pouring. I want to tell you something different. It goes even deeper than that. If you have a great big dirt stain on a piece of clothing, the soap and the water have to get right into the very fibers to clean it out. And the blood of Jesus isn't just a covering so that when God looks on you, it's all okay. The blood of Jesus reaches down into each and every one of those places that you are ashamed of, that you can't help but do, and it cleans it out. It changes and transforms. The blood of Jesus shed for you. Atonement. The blood of Jesus. And then the third thing that happens here in this passage that points to the cross as well and all Jesus has done is the very next verse. To demonstrate his righteousness. In this present time, to be the one, verse 26, to be the just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. The illustrations often given in the Alpha Course and elsewhere of two friends who grew up at university together, and then life took them on different paths. One became a judge and a successful judge, and the other one fell on really hard times. He got himself caught up in all kinds of different things and didn't know what to do and ended up being in the courtroom with his friend as the judge. And at the end of this case, what was clear is the guy was guilty. And so the judge had to say and had to give the declaration, yes, you are guilty. And in that, he had to pay a certain amount of money. The guy had no money. The guy was going to be stuck in jail for ages. At this very moment, the judge took off his wig. He walked down and stood alongside and wrote a check for the money so that his friend could walk free. The case has happened. The case has been done. The case is dusted. No accusation could ever come against the person again. It's all been dealt with. That's the image of the law court. There's a whole load of other ways of looking at these, but can you not see three most amazing images of God redeeming you, God atoning and cleaning you, and God setting you free so that nobody can accuse you, so that nothing can ever separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus again? You've been set free. That's at the heart of the grace of the gospel. That's why Paul says it is the power for those who believe. That's why he says it is good news. Three things there. And in the next part, it talks about the story of Abraham. And it's a pivotal story. And for the Jews and the Gentiles, they would have known the story of Abraham in those days. And the hard point that we need to pick up from the story of Abraham here is before the law was given, before many other things had happened, Abraham chose to follow God. God spoke to him and said, Abraham, go. And he did, and it was credited to him as righteousness. The whole point is Abraham's journey of faith was responding to God, and so is our journey of faith, responding to God. It's responding to what God has said and what he has done. The promise given to Abraham when he followed God was that there would be a blessing to all the nations. And now each and every person can come to know God through Jesus, a descendant of Abraham. Each and every person can come to know God. It is a free gift that is entered to in a life of faith. We only have to choose what God has done for us so that we can follow. It's a free gift. When we do a baptism here at church, so often we said, talk about how faith is already at work. This is a response to what God is doing. God speaks, God leans down into our mess and pulls us out. You know, the point is, if I hadn't jumped and caught hold of my friend's arm, he'd have never pulled me over the wall. Jesus is coming this close and holding his hand out to you and saying, will you please choose a new start? Will you please come with me? Will you please know my forgiveness and my love? Will you please allow your life to be changed? That's what's at the heart of this gospel. That's what is reminding in. And if we can have that understanding and that confidence, it leads us to be able to live a new life. Abraham lived it with boldness. That's the whole point. We too can live it with boldness. We can trust again and go on an adventure. My bet is a load of you thought we would never build this church, rebuild it. We went on an adventure and God completed it. In each of your lives, God has an individual adventure for you that if you follow and be bold for us as a church, as we follow and are bold in that moment, that's when God comes through. It's a life of trusting and adventure. But it's also a free gift. So it's not a life of boasting of we've got it all sorted or we've got this. It's a life of saying, thank you, Jesus. For under the cross, we're all the same. We're all human. And yet, because of you, we have a new start. And therefore, because of you, we will share the good news that all of us can have a new start. A new start that echoes from this life to eternity. A new start that brings hope and peace and joy. So be grateful, not boastful. Be adventurous, not cautious. and choose to follow. Each and every one of us can stay stuck in sin. Or each and every one of us can choose to allow Jesus to meet with us, to pull us out of our pits and lead us on into life and life eternal. Sure, we won't get it all right. Sure, we'll all make mistakes. Sure, we're all human. But the blood of Jesus cleanses us from sins. The blood of Jesus gives us a new start. It is a free grace for everyone. No one is put outside. The choice is to trust in Jesus. That simple. That's the good news. That's why we talk about it. That's why we share it. That's what the heart of our faith is, to choose to trust in Jesus. And so I believe God's wanting us to do something simple this morning. And it may be that for some of you, you've known Jesus for a while, but you've not trusted him as much. And he's wanting you just to choose to trust him again, to allow him to lead and guide you again, to allow him to set you free from whatever it is that's binding you or holding you down. For some of you, you've never heard this before. Or you've never heard it like this, that it's a simple trust in Jesus that transforms lives by the power of his Spirit and the power of the resurrection. And what Jesus is doing is he's gently inviting you today just to choose to hold his hand and to follow him and to walk with him. That's what God's inviting us to do, to then go as a church on the journey of experiencing and living the good news and being able to share the good news. But the opportunity this day is in the same way that Abraham did, the same way that Paul did, in the same way the Roman church did, the same way that we can do, is to say that, yes, Jesus, you are enough, and I choose to follow. I choose to believe the good news in Jesus. I choose to have a new start. I choose to allow myself to be set free. We're going to explore it in more detail, what it means over the next few weeks, the peace we have, the hope we have, the joy we have, the strength we have. But it starts by choosing to join Jesus and get out of the pit. And my bet is this week and last week, something has most probably been stirring in you, and you might have had tears or you might have other stuff, but the Lord just wants to come and meet with you and cleanse you. And so our response today, I'm not going to do a big come out to the front or anything else. If you would like to either just know Jesus for the first time, or if you would like to just connect with him again because you feel at a distance, just invite you either to bow your head or to kneel down. Because actually we're saying, Jesus, you died for us. You died for me. Your blood sets me free. And so I just invite you, if you'd like to, why don't you bow your head or to kneel in this space. And it may be even in the space, there might be things that are coming to mind that you just would love Jesus to forgive you for. He knows it. He's forgiven you anyway. But we can invite his forgiveness in. And so, Lord Jesus, in this space, we thank you for the good news. We thank you that no longer do you leave us stuck in this place. Lord Jesus, we are sorry for the wrongs that we have done and we've thought and we have said. Will you come by your Spirit into this space? And will you bring the cleansing power of Jesus into our lives? Will you help us to know your forgiveness? Will you clean us out? And enable us to go on the new journey with you. Help us to receive your love and your grace. Help us to know that nothing can ever separate us from your love. Help us to know that nothing we've done cannot be forgiven because of Jesus. And so, Lord Jesus, bring your forgiveness to us now. And as you bring your forgiveness, give us the strength to follow, the strength to be bold and adventurous like Abraham, the strength to be bold and adventurous for the future. Make us grateful and enabled to share your message. And so, as we're here in this space, why don't you continue to respond and open up your life to the work of the Spirit in this moment? And if you wish to join in as the band's here, you're welcome. If you just want to sit or kneel a little longer, the Holy Spirit, will you bring the cleansing and a new start and new hope in Jesus to each and every one of us? May we know your forgiveness here in this place, in your name. Thank you so much for joining with us here this morning. It's been great to be able to connect and worship with you all. And we hope that you're able to enjoy wherever you are. It's also a huge thank you to all those of you that support our ministries in so many ways and through the generosity of your giving. If you'd like to join with those that support in that way, full details can be found on our website and you can go there using the QR code on the video in a moment. But let's take a few more moments just to receive God's blessing this morning. And I invite you just to open up your hands, just as a sign of openness to receive from the Lord. And so may the God of hope himself, may he fill you with all joy and peace, so that as you trust in him, your life might overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And so may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you, remain with you, surround you, and flow from you now and always. Amen.